testing the spirits and understanding that there are a lot of things out there that are trying to bid for our attention, trying to bid for our allegiance, trying to get us to focus on them and pulling us left and right, trying to help to distract us away from what God really wants. Test the spirits. In construction, there are several things that we use to test to make sure that the building that we're putting together is coming up correctly. The first is a framing square. A good, nice right angle, but it tells if things are perpendicular to one another as they are supposed to be for the building that we're putting together, whether it's wood or metal. Another is, they call this a bubble level, but we just call it a level. They're 4-foot level. It can tell if things are level on the horizon, but also if they're plumb going up and down. These are necessary as we're trying to get things to be correct. And we have to measure them. We have to go back and double check ourselves. And if it's something really tall, we'll use our tape measure to make sure that it's square. You measure from one side, one corner to the next, and one corner over here to the next to make sure the measurements are equal. That's how we work in construction, to test, to make sure that what we're putting together will not look like the Leaning Tower of Pisa. How do we do that in the real world? We use God's Word. How do we test the spirits? We compare it to God's Word. What message are we hearing from a preacher or a teacher? A prophet out there, someone who's saying negative things or saying things that just sounds good, but it may not be good. How do we measure it? We measure it against God's Word. Always against God's Word. 1 John chapter 4, as we continue our study in the book of 1 John. Great preacher Charles Spurgeon said this, "I often laugh at Satan, and there's nothing that makes him so angry as when I attack him to his face and tell him that through God, I'm more than any match for him." There was a Latin proverb that went this way. It said, "The first step of wisdom is to know what is false." The first step of wisdom is to know what is false. God's Word teaches us the truth. And that's what we use to compare to the everything else in our lives. We begin verse 1 of chapter 4. It says, "Dear friends, do not believe every spirit, but test the spirits to see whether they are from God. Because many false prophets," meaning preachers, teachers, "have gone into the world. This is how you can recognize them. Recognize the Spirit of God. Every spirit that acknowledges that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is from God. But every spirit that does not acknowledge Jesus is not from God. This is the spirit of the Antichrist, which you have heard is coming, and even now is already in the world. You, dear children, are from God and have overcome them, because the one who is in you is greater than the one who is in the world. They are from the world and therefore speak from the viewpoint of the world, and the world listens to them. We are from God, and whoever knows God listens to us, but whoever is not from God does not listen to us. This is how we recognize the spirit of truth and the spirit of falsehood." Let's pray together. Father God, I ask you this morning, God, that you bring our minds together, Lord. You bring our senses together and help us to understand what you're trying to teach us in your Word. Lord, we're encountering so many things, so many messages that come across to us, so many temptations that tempt to lure us away. And Father, oftentimes we have to say that we're very weak. In our own strength, we have nothing. But God, in the power of your Holy Spirit, in the power of your holy word, God, we have strength to navigate through this life. Teach us today what you have for us to learn, how to be an overcomer. In Jesus' name, amen. There are several pieces of wisdom this morning that we can learn to navigate through the deceptive waters that we may come in contact with, so that we can be overcomers in this life. And the first is this. First piece of wisdom is to be cautious, not gullible. To be cautious in life and not gullible. Listen, there are too many people who are not trying to be cautious. There are too many people who will believe anything that kind of sounds good. See, Christians should not be foolish to follow unfamiliar teaching which contradict or alienate God's word. Christians must learn to be wise and discern what teaching someone is spreading. We must be cautious and remain on guard at all times to the soothing words of people who claim to have our best interest in mind or claim to have some answers of inner peace and eternal life apart from Jesus Christ. We see in verse 1 says, "Do not believe every spirit." Because someone calls themselves reverend or bishop or pastor or whatever else title they want to put themselves on, you don't have to believe what they say because it sounds good. We must trust God's word and agree that there are supernatural influences of evil in the world who are bidding for our attention and our allegiance. Realize, as we studied in Daniel back last summer, you remember that there's this battle going on in the spirit world for your attention. There's this battle going on for your prayers. There's this battle going on all the time. We can't see it, but it's happening. And there's this battle going on. Listen, if you're not saved, it's a battle for your soul. If you're saved, it's a battle for your attention. It's bidding for you to get sidetracked over here, to begin to chase after things that are not from God. Do not believe every doctrine. There are demonic beings who work through people to reach others, to lure them away from the Savior Jesus Christ. Do not believe all their doctrines. Spiritual experiences are supernatural mysteries. You cannot be one with the universe. And that's a big spiritual teaching today. Some cults and spiritualists claim, do not be gullible enough to trust every story of out-of-body experiences. Don't be gullible enough to believe everything that comes down. Every spirit and deceitful imaginations can manipulate circumstances. Evil spirits can deceive and manipulate circumstances to fool people who are not found, they have their foundation in God's word, that are not familiar with what God's word says. Listen, there are people who do have spiritual experiences, but when they compare it to God's word, it matches up. There are people who do have godly experiences, and God's word prove it to be genuine. Do not believe every spirit. Why? Verse 1 says, because many false prophets have gone out. So John is talking to the church, and he's saying, listen, there are a lot who left, and they're teaching things that I'm not teaching you. There are things that are not biblical. These things are not of God. These things are not sound doctrine that Jesus Christ passed on to us. What they're teaching out there is falsehoods. You need to be very much aware. They've gone out from us. Listen, that puts red flags up. And Christians, we need to be very much aware that there are people and there are preachers who do not follow God's word. They may pick and choose things, but they're not following God's word. God's word is clear. There are false teachers, false preachers, and religions, cults, New Age spiritualists. They can all propagate a message of spiritual renewal, but it's based on demonic manipulation of the truth of God's word. Get this, the devil knows God's word. He knows it. He is super intelligent. He knows and can quote God's word to us. False teachers and cults proliferate because people have this inward, natural, God-created desire to worship. God meant this yearning, this desire to worship Him. God gave it to us all so that we would worship Him. But when we are not focused upon God, we begin worshiping ourselves or anything else. False teachers focus on glorifying themselves, fulfilling this insatiable desire for pleasure, for prosperity, for power. Listen, that's how you can tell. Listen to some preachers out there that they're going through God's word, and boy, they're picking out all kind of verses out of the Bible that are geared to lure you in to thinking that you are number one and not Jesus Christ. Be cautious. Don't be gullible. Be cautious, because many are led astray by their own desires, and they begin to pick and choose and homemade their own spiritualism. Many times people's belief system looks like this collage of, well, I believe what this denomination says, and I believe what this preacher says, and I like this over here, and I like this over here, and they begin to bring it all together, and this is their belief system, and it has nothing reflective of what God's Word says. It's filled with likes and dislikes. Be cautious, not gullible. The second piece of wisdom is this: be spiritually assertive, not apathetic. To be spiritually assertive, but not apathetic. Believers are urged to be proactive in comparing spiritual doctrines with God's Word. Listen, we have to actively compare what a teacher or denomination or religion is saying to God's Word. We have to be active about that. We can't just assume, well, you know, I guess they're good too. Any religion, any person, any denomination without Jesus Christ is going to hell. Point blank. That's it. There's no way to redefine that. There's no way to get around that. And for us as Christians, just to assume that everybody else is okay puts us very apathetic toward lost souls. We need to see that the same transforming grace that God gave us, they need also. We see in the latter part of verse 1, it says, test the spirits. We must know. How can we test something? We must know what we know when we know it. Listen, if you're new to our church or thinking about uniting with this church, we need to get you in a class. It's called the next step class. Listen, all you have to do is fill out this little green card and say, listen, I'm interested in going to next step class to get you a foundation. Why? Because you need something to put you on the level of understanding who Jesus Christ is. It gives you that foundation that you need to grow in Christ. That's where we are, is that we need to know what we know, what we know. On Wednesday nights, I teach a class, and it's really systematic theology. It's helping all those who come grow deeper in understanding in their faith. And we try to get all those little details so that we can grow. So we hear a message, we know whether it's true or not. We know whether it's real or not. We must know what we know. Why? So we can see whether a message is authentic from the truth of God. Many doctors and spiritual disciplines resonate well with religious jargon. They have a lot of religious terminology, but do not align with the teachings of Christ or the New Testament. See, God's Word is our pattern from which we all accept doctrines. We must conform to it when we must conform to God's doctrines when it's found in God's Word, and we must reject anything that's not. And listen, just because Momo believed it doesn't make it right. I'm going to repeat that. Just because Momo and Papa believed it doesn't make it right. Well, yeah, but Momo and Papa were in God's Word all the time. Really? What teachers were they listening to? Be an adult. Read it yourself. Find the truth in God's Word. We must test the spirits. Men and women who teach and preach a prosperity message that name it and claim it doctrine are out of bounds with God's Word. Their message sounds so hopeful and alluring to materialistic-minded people. Listen, greed camouflaged in God's Word. Greed camouflaged by religion. Greed is still greed, and that's sin. When you're serious about receiving the abundance of God, you'll stop looking at your bank account and start looking to the Savior. Jesus was not interested in anything but people. He didn't care how much money he had in the treasure. He was interested in people. And he used the finances that people gave and donated to what they were doing for people, so they could minister to people. Good stewardship does bring God's favor, but the doctrine of a prosperity message is riddled with false hope. To be sure of that, ask someone in a third world country who's received Jesus as Savior, who's living out of a garbage dump, whose house is nothing but a few sheets of tin on a few pieces of wood or pallets. They're not living the prosperity on earth. They're living the prosperity in Christ. Be assertive. Test the spirits. Shirin Suzuki said this: if your mind is empty, it is always ready for anything. It is open to everything. In the beginning, the beginner's mind, there are many possibilities. But in the expert's mind, there are few. You see, the more we know about God's Word, the more we begin to see these things that aren't real, these things that aren't true, these things that we just begin to discern and make out. And listen, there'll be thousands of people maybe following that, but God's Word said that's not right. We must mature in our faith to be sensitive to the Holy Spirit and God's Word so we can test the spirits. Whether our minds being open to anything and everything. Listen, when we're not in God's Word, we don't really know what God's Word says. Our minds are empty. So when someone says something that sounds religious, when they put it on and help us to begin to grasp this idea because they created this idea, listen, if it's not found in God's Word, we'll quickly... sometimes, if our mind is empty, we'll quickly receive it. Listen there. Let me just say this with all sensitivity. When a child passes, I've read many, many times and heard people make comment, oh, he's an angel now, or she's an angel now. No. They're with Jesus, but they don't become an angel. You see, humans have a higher place than angels with heaven. Matter of fact, the Bible says humans will judge the angels. And I know that's a sensitive subject, and some people, it sounds so good, and we want to embrace it, but it's just not true. Just because something sounds good doesn't mean it is good, doesn't mean it's right. See, there's no biblical proof to back up what sounds good in that situation. We must mature in our faith, get in God's Word, and know how to test the spirits. The third piece of wisdom is this: discern the Spirit's message. We have to discern the Spirit's message. Christians must be able to identify the truth of God when confronted with a twisted message meant to deceive. Can you identify the false a message from a false religion or denomination or preacher? Do you know when God is moving with His truth? Do you have difficulty identifying God at work? Do you know things that are true when you hear them about God, about Christ? Can you detect false teachings? See, John addressed this to believers because these teachers were coming up. And these were the church. Now, this is in the church. And they were saying they were doubting the deity of Christ Jesus. That was their teaching. Listen, there's a mainline cult, even here in Ville Platte. Jehovah's Witnesses believe this. If you could turn your Bibles to John chapter 1, verse 1, they say this: in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. This is what our Bible says. Jehovah's Witnesses changed that. It says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was a God. That's denying the deity of Christ. That's denying the Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, by simply injecting one word. Do you see? If you don't know God's Word, you would simply believe that. But when you're in God's Word, even something as simple as adding one letter word changed the whole context of that passage. They're saying that Jesus is somehow a little God, but not the big God. John addresses these teachers. These false teachings presented Jesus as less than God in the flesh. They asserted that He was a great man, maybe He was a prophet, but He was not 100% God, 100% man. He was not God in the flesh. He was not Emmanuel, God with us. And John addressed it straight on. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12 says, God's Word is alive and working, is sharper than any double-edged sword. It cuts all the way into us, where the soul and the spirit are joined, the center of our joints and bones. And it judges the thoughts and the feelings of our hearts. Nothing in all the world can be hidden from God. We have to be able to scrutinize the teachings of people. There are preachers today on TV who will go through Scripture and they'll pull out all the positive things. And it irks me because you know what? Life is not all about the positive things. I only want to hear positive. I only think positive. Listen, Ephesians chapter 2, verse 1 says, you were dead in your transgressions and sin. That without Christ Jesus, you are spiritually dead. You cannot live a spiritual life apart from Christ. Why? Because you're dead. That's not just positive thinking. We have to see the wholeness of Scripture. If we want to get where God wants us to be, we have to see the wholeness of Scripture. From Genesis to Revelation, what does God's Word tell us? And then we can compare our lives to that. We can compare messages coming into that. We can scrutinize things that are coming our way. That's how we do it. It is the plumb line of our faith. It is the plumb line of what believe. Listen, you can go through and pull out scriptures all you want, and you can create your own religion. You can go through God, well, I like that, so I'm going to pull that out. Well, I don't like that, so I'm going to tear it out. So I like this, this, and this, but I don't really like what Jesus says over here. If you're here today just to feel good about yourself,
you're going to be disappointed. I'd rather the Holy Spirit make you, help you sense to where you're at in your relationship with God than to pat you on the back and say, hey, everything's wonderful. Go about your way. You're a wonderful human being. Keep doing what you're doing. And you die and go to hell. We need to be able to scrutinize what people say. And life is not always about the positive. There are negative circumstances in this life. And only by the power of the Holy Spirit can we work through them. Only by His power can we have discernment. Only by His power can we see where He's trying to take us. And only by His discernment and understanding what God's Word says about it can we see that there's a bigger life than just thinking positive. We need to be able to scrutinize what we hear. I can't, as a pastor, go through and just pull out good things to tell you every Sunday. That's not doing you justice. It's not doing justice to God's Word. I would be a liar. I want to teach you what everything that God's Word says so that you can live the life that is honoring and pleasing to God. And where the shoe fits, hey, put it on there and allow God to work in it. So we need to be cautious. We need to test the spirits. We need to scrutinize the teachings of others so we can discern the truth. And the fourth and last piece of wisdom is this, is that really you are an overcomer. See, John is addressing his church, and the people who were reading it were in the church. They hadn't left. He said, you are an overcomer. Why? Because your faith has proven that you're still on task. You're still going. You are an overcomer. You did not follow those false teachings. You didn't get led out into the temptations of the world. You're still going. He didn't say they were perfect. He said, you're still going. God has chosen you to be His child, and He has equipped you for victory in your life through Christ Jesus. Verse 4 says this, you, dear children, are from God and have overcame them, or overcome them. John addresses this to his church in endearment, to affirm their faith that they have been following God and they have been given victory. John admonishes their discernment of truth versus false teaching. They have overcome demonic influence and peer pressure to unite with those who spread false messages of God. Could you imagine inside that church these teachers rising up and gathering a following? Could you imagine these church brothers, these church members against one another? And how those following the false teaching was trying to coax the others into following also? To lead them astray? But they were sound in their doctrine, and they wouldn't follow. Listen, there are a lot of superstar preachers today on TVs, radio, putting books out left and right. And there are a lot of people who are walking away from the church to follow them. They're doing it. And then there are those who know God's Word to look at that and say, that's not a real message they're preaching. And they're being overcomers. And listen, it's real impressive to see 30,000 people sitting in a church or stadium or whatever else they have. That's real impressive. I want you to know this. If Jesus was impressed by numbers, and if He was the man that we follow for church growth programs, He was a complete failure. You see, He fed thousands. But there's one time He said He fed 5,000 plus men and women and children. So it's probably 15,000 people He fed miraculously. Another time it was 4,000. But when He ascended into heaven, there was only 120 in Jerusalem praying for the Holy Spirit to fall. 120.
That's not exactly a church growth program that worked according to today's standards. God is not impressed by numbers. He's impressed by what's in here. He's looking here. Why are we believers, overcomers? Verse 4 says, because the one who is in you is greater than the one who is in the world. You are an overcomer in this life because greater is the Holy Spirit living in you than anything or anyone in this world. You've been power. You have the power to defeat temptation, to endure testing, to persevere through struggles, and to discern the deceitful influences of false teachings. You have the power in the Spirit of God to lead you in the right direction. You have the power in the Spirit of God to teach you. This is not a history book. This is not a science book. This is God's love letter to us. This is about the revelation of Jesus Christ. Nothing has authority to overwhelm the power of the Holy Spirit living inside of you. Jesus died and He shed His blood to save us and summon us to live our lives in victory through all the mountains and all the valleys that will come. Satan tells you that all your hope is gone. You're going to live in defeat if you follow that Jesus. Look what everyone else is doing. That's the way you need to do it. And he's lying. I'll remind you that Satan is a liar. He does not have authority over you in anything. We see in verse 13 of John chapter 4, 1 John 4, says, and God has given us His Spirit as proof that we live in Him and He in us. What are you contending with this morning? What are you wrestling with and trying to make decisions on how to follow? Maybe it's you're trying to find your way and help understand what God is wanting to do in your life. Maybe you're battling with this temptation, this persistent thing that keeps coming back over you. Listen, you are an overcomer. Test the spirit of it. Test the spirit. You hear messages and you hear teachings that's brought out by some. Test it according to God's word. John 16, 13 says, I've told you all this so that you may have peace in me. Here on earth you will have many trials and sorrows, but take heart because I have overcome the world. How do you know? How do you know? When you're discerning the truth is when you're going to God's word and you're finding affirmation to the things that you believe, first of all, and that you're discerning and pushing aside the things that you know don't match up and line up with God's word. Jesus tells us in John chapter 10, verse 27, my sheep know my voice, and they follow me. They follow me. There are a lot of voices out there calling for your attention. A lot of voices that are looking for you to get sidestepped. There are temptations in the world and there's false teaching in the world. But always remember this, God's word is the device that we measure all of them with. And when it doesn't match up with God's word, and it's not found in God's word, then you can't incorporate it into your belief system. And you need to back up and run away because that's not where God wants you to be. There were some who fell in the early church. They followed these false leaders. They followed these false teachings. And John brings that same warning down to us. Listen, in 2017, there are a lot of false teachers out there. There are a lot of temptations in the world that want to lead us astray. There's people picketing and marching about all kinds of stuff. Measure it up to God's word. Just measure it up. You'll be led in the right direction. You are an overcomer. How do you overcome these challenges? By testing the spirits. Let's pray together. Father God, we thank you today for everything that you're doing.
Lord, I pray today that you move in a mighty way to everyone who's come our way. Lord, I ask you that you intervene in lives. God, there are people who are hurting. There are people who need you right now. God, there are people who need direction. God, they've been taught things all their life and it just doesn't match up with Scripture. Lord, I pray that you lead them according to your word, your will, under the power of your Holy Spirit. In Christ's name, amen. Let's stand together this morning.